Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Well, What We Need to Talk About When We Talk About Health by Sandro Galea. Read by Keith Sellon-Wright. Preface. I am a physician and an epidemiologist, a doctor who studies how diseases spread by profession. I am also an immigrant, twice over, and a father. I was born in Malta, a small island about one-tenth the size of Rhode Island, located in the Mediterranean between Sicily and Tunisia. During my childhood, Malta went through a period of political unrest, mass civil disobedience, and violence. The changes did not bode well for my family, and we left the island in 1985 when I was a teenager. We moved to Canada, which at the time was one of two countries, Australia was the other, accepting Maltese immigrants. There, we lived with my aunt, who had immigrated previously in a Toronto suburb called Scarborough, where a fair number of immigrants lived, and still do. Later, we moved to a housing project nearby. I did a year and a bit of high school, then attended Scarborough College, a commuter campus of the University of Toronto. I went to medical school in Canada and then practiced medicine in a rural part of northern Canada. I also worked in places like Papua New Guinea and the Philippines, and with Doctors Without Borders in Somalia. When I was approaching 30, I immigrated to the United States to study public health. I have since made my professional living here, conducting research and teaching at the University of Michigan, Columbia University, and now Boston University. My children are fully American, and I am now very much at home here. But I have little doubt that my sensibility is shaped by a personal journey that gives me deep empathy with vulnerable and marginalized groups. At the same time, my journey imbues me with genuine optimism about the potential to always improve the human condition. And by professional orientation, I want us to be better on health. Experience living around the world has taught me that health is universally valued and that all members of the human family wish to be healthier. My training in medicine and public health tells me that we can do just that, provided we first change what we talk about when we talk about health. That is what this book is about. Sandro Galea, July 18, 2018, Boston. Introduction. In 1977, NASA launched the unmanned Voyager 1 space probe, the goal of which was to explore the outermost reaches of space and transmit data back to Earth. On board was a gold-plated record containing a range of sounds that would convey to any alien being that discovered it the breadth and diversity of the human experience on Earth. One song on the record is "Dark Was the Night, Cold Was the Ground," a recording from 1927 by the blues singer Blind Willie Johnson. Blind Willie Johnson had a difficult life. The story goes that when Willie was 7 years old, as his father was beating Willie's stepmother over allegations of infidelity, the stepmother angrily threw lye in Willie's face, blinding him. Willie experienced poverty throughout the life that followed, getting by on money earned playing music and preaching in the streets. In 1945, his house burned to the ground. With nowhere to go, he lived in the ruins, sleeping on a damp bed. Amid these living conditions, he soon caught malaria and died. His wife said that he had been refused treatment at a hospital, either because he was blind or because he was black. When I tell this story to groups, I ask them a question. What killed Blind Willie Johnson? The answer may seem obvious. Malaria killed Blind Willie Johnson. If he had received treatment for it, Blind Willie would have lived. But would he have lived much longer? Anyone who appreciates the sum of hardships that were building up in Blind Willie's life will recognize that if malaria had not killed him on September 18, 1945, something else was likely going to kill him soon thereafter. In fact, one might fairly argue that he was killed by poverty, by racism, by domestic violence, by homelessness, and by limited access to care. And in this regard, he was not alone. Today, black children in America are far more likely to witness domestic violence than white ones, and while doctors may not be able to turn patients away on account of race anymore, pernicious gaps in treatment remain. Blind Willie Johnson's health was shaped by being born at a certain time in a certain place, in a certain skin, under certain social and economic circumstances. The sum of all these factors is what ultimately defined his life experience and killed him at an early age. On hearing this story, most will regret what happened to Johnson, lamenting how such things continue to happen to people today. One may even hope to do something to help those who are affected by adverse conditions today so that those people can be healthier. These are admirable sentiments, but they miss a core truth. We are all Blind Willie Johnson. Each of us is shaped by the conditions around us, the combination of place, time, power, money, and connections, by what we know and by the compassion of the people we encounter. And, importantly, our health depends on these things too. This book aims to make this case, that our health is not defined by things like seeing doctors or taking medicines or getting in our 5,000 steps a day. Rather, it's defined by the full spectrum of our life circumstances, from the families we come from, to the neighborhoods where we live, to the people we see and the choices we make. And unless we understand those forces, our health is never going to improve. The room for improvement in Americans' health is well documented. In fact, by most measures, American health is worse than that of any other rich country. Child mortality in the United States is about 7 per 1,000. In Finland, it's 2 per 1,000. A child born today in America can expect to live until age 79. In Japan, that child would live to 84. Yet, somehow we spend nearly twice as much as Japan does on health per capita. Most well-informed Americans are aware of this trend. It has become accepted that we live sicker and die earlier than people in other rich countries. What most do not realize is that this is a relatively new development. While the United States has made continuing progress on improving life expectancy and reducing mortality from various diseases, these improvements have occurred at a much slower rate than in other countries over the past 40 years. For example, Chilean life expectancy was 68 in 1980. It was 81 by 2014. By comparison, U.S. life expectancy was 74 in 1980, and by 2014, it lagged behind Chile's at 79. And the United States is not just faring worse than other high-income countries. In 1980, Cuban life expectancy was 74. In 2005, it was 79, higher than 77 in the United States. Today, children born in America are likelier to live shorter lives than children born in a range of other countries, including Singapore, life expectancy 83, and Greece, life expectancy 81. Is this because Americans care less about health than do people in other countries? Far from it. The United States spent $3.3 trillion in 2016 on health. That is the same as the entire gross domestic product of Germany. America spends about 18% of its annual gross domestic product on health. The country that spends the second most is Switzerland, which spends 12%. Most of the 37 countries that are part of the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development spend somewhere around 9%. Much of Americans' health expenditures go toward doctors and medicines. That is, money spent on getting better after we are sick. The inefficiency of this approach shines a light on how Americans historically conflate the concept of health with the practice of medicine, and how our national health conversation is dominated by a belief that treating illness is somehow easier or better than preventing that illness in the first place. It is hard to think of any other aspect of American life where the country's shortcomings are as stark as with its health, let alone one where it would be remotely as accepted. Would Americans accept spending more than anyone else on its military if it was understood that our military was weaker than those of other countries? How would we feel if we continued to spend more on our military over a period of decades, only to fall further and further behind other countries? It would probably amount to a national crisis and prompt some real soul-searching and hand-wringing around why we have been spending ever more while getting ever less. All this happens because we think about health in the wrong way. We think that improving health is an individual enterprise focused on the individual. We think that lifestyle will amount to living long as we can afford all the medicines we need to keep going. But study after study shows that our country's health output per dollar is worse than any of our peer countries, and study after study also shows that efforts to change our lifestyle generally fall short just a few months after we make these efforts. This means we've been spending our money on ineffectual, finger-wagging efforts to modify behaviors, then later on medicine to help us after we get sick. Based on the evidence, that appears to be the wrong approach. This book is about the forces around us that shape health, most of which we do not think about. These are forces that are typically not in the health discussion, but based on research, should be. To take that statement a step further, this book is about factors that have to align with the goal of creating the healthiest possible people if we are to reap the benefits of our investment in health. We spend an inordinate amount of money on health, yes. Most of the time, we have been spending that money incorrectly. We have been spending on trying to do things by ourselves, to change behaviors that aren't likely to change in light of the vortex of factors that contributed to the behaviors in the first place. We have been spending our money on medicine, looking to cure ourselves after we have become sick, rather than investing in the things that will prevent us from getting sick in the first place. The fact that we spend so much and get so relatively little for it is evidence that we cannot buy our way out of this problem. Despite having the best hospitals in the world, Americans will still get sick more than people living in other countries and will then die at a younger age. And for all our best intentions in health, to eat better, to exercise more, we will keep falling short because our world and environment are not aligned to encourage us to do these things. The society we have created is simply not oriented to keep us healthy. Until our world is oriented in a way that is conducive to health, we will continue to fall behind on health and never come close to realizing our full potential, even amid extraordinary health-related spending. Our efforts to make ourselves healthy without a world around us that encourages health will never be sufficient. At the end of the day, it does not matter so much how great our hospitals are or how advanced our technology. Our health is determined by and limited by the world in which we live. The good news is that introducing the matters of actual consequence to our dialogues around health doesn't cost any more than we're already spending. But it will require that we pay greater attention to certain things than we do now, and that sort of behavior change is no small trick. The goal here has to be to shift what we talk about when we talk about health. The chapters of this book show how what we value, how we live, where we live, and who is in power are all drivers of our health, individually and collectively. It explains how, until we have a more just world, health will continue to suffer. And it explains why forces as abstract as empathy and humility matter for our health, and critically, why we must embrace their influence. My bias, as a writer, as a doctor, as an immigrant, as an academic, as a father, is that I hope to live in a healthier world for all. In this book, I attempt to explain the various factors in our broader context that we know create good health. It's important to note that I am not interested in disease, and I seldom talk about sickness. I am interested in health, in the creation of a world where as many of us as possible are healthy for as long as possible. While our health is personal, I am interested in how everyone, as many people as possible, can be as healthy as possible for as long as possible. To that end, I hope that this book can serve as a meditation of sorts, guiding one to better understand the forces that actually shape our health. From there, maybe we can turn to investing in these very forces and creating a healthier world. In many ways, this book is a reflection of my own personal journey in health. I was born in Malta and immigrated to Canada, where I was trained as a physician in primary care medicine. I spent time working in rural and remote parts of the world, including Somalia, where I worked as a field physician with Doctors Without Borders. I was in Somalia in the late 1990s, where I was truly immersed in the most acute form of clinical medicine, dealing with sick people coming through the door whose lives, literally, depended on me and what I did to help them. People whose malaria, and there was a lot of malaria, depended on my treating it properly in order for them to live. While in Somalia, treating mostly preventable diseases and injuries, I felt very much like the proverbial man at the side of the river who sees one person drowning and jumps in to save her, then sees another person drowning and jumps in to save him, and then yet another person and jumps in to save her. After a while, I stopped to ask, who is throwing people in the river to begin with? With that question began my academic journey. My professional life has been focused on finding out who is throwing people in the river and what I can do about that upstream influence so that we are not all drowning and depending on doctors to fish us out. The forces around us are what throws us in the river. They are our past, money, power, place, people, love and hate, compassion, the choices we make, luck, fairness and justice, and our values. My hope is that if we all understand these forces a little bit better, we will have fewer people drowning in the river, and that the Blind Willie Johnsons of the world will live another day. 1. The past. Sophia was born to a mother who could not quite afford her. Financially insecure all her life, she gave birth at 17 and supported Sophia by working two jobs, one at a fast food restaurant, the other at a laundromat at the other end of the city. Because of her mother's long commute and longer hours, Sophia's care fell largely to a cousin who allowed her to spend most of her time eating potato chips and watching television. Despite this indulgence, which left her slightly overweight, Sophia was by no means lazy. She always made sure the family apartment was clean and well-ordered, keeping everything neat while her mother was away. Yet there were limits to what she could do to ensure the cleanliness of her surroundings. Her home was close to the local bus depot, where all day long the vehicles pumped thick diesel fumes into the air. As a consequence, Sophia was plagued by severe asthma that often kept her from school. Her grades tended to be low, with the exception of math. When it came to numbers, she quickly surpassed her peers and even some of the students in the year ahead of her. Recognizing Sophia's potential, one of her teachers recommended her for special enrichment classes. Unfortunately, this meant someone would have to regularly drive Sophia home after school, and she had no such someone in her life. She never took the classes. When she was about 16, Sophia became pregnant and dropped out of school. Her mother, still working two jobs, had not been around to counsel her about reproductive safety, and the cursory sexual education provided by Sophia's school emphasized abstinence far more than it did condoms. So Sophia, still living under her mother's roof, followed in her mother's footsteps, working multiple low-wage jobs to make ends meet and support her daughter. The stress of these jobs and the pressures of young motherhood took a toll on her health. By the time she was 28, she was 40 pounds overweight, her asthma was worse, and she was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. To cope with these conditions, she was soon prescribed 3 medications by her doctor. This strained her income and her capacity to help her mother keep up payments on the apartment. As time passed, and once her daughter became a bit more independent, Sophia was able to consolidate her work life into a single, stable job. She became the manager of a crew at a catering company. She enjoyed working with her team, earned good money, and often received praise from the company's owner. But the pace and physical nature of the work did no favors for her health. By her mid-40s, Sophia's asthma and diabetes were poorly controlled. She developed osteoarthritis in both knees, brought on by her extra weight. Her doctor told her she would soon need surgery to address these problems, which would take her off her feet and away from the work for which she had shown such aptitude. She tried to defer the surgery, and her doctor prescribed opioids for her knee pain. Sophia quickly developed a dependence on the drugs. After a fall at work, her doctor told her that a corrective procedure could no longer wait. Sophia, at age 45, was now receiving regular medical attention and headed to early surgery. Sophia's story captures the essence of how our health is shaped by our past, and how our past is, in turn, shaped by a range of social, economic, and environmental conditions. If we were to meet Sophia as our story leaves her, age 45, overweight, suffering from the combined effects of asthma, diabetes, and osteoarthritis, it would be easy to see how her physical challenges undermine her present health. It would be less easy to see how the circumstances of her personal history laid the groundwork for these challenges to emerge. Sophia's medical picture at 45 is as much the result of her health in the years preceding as the day her surgery was deemed necessary. Her health is a product of her life, and her life, like all lives, is complex. Nutrition, culture, income, race, family dynamics, and educational attainment, all these factors are unique to individuals, and together they define our individual complexities. It should come as little surprise, then, that Sophia does not need surgery at age 45 because of any one issue. She needs it because of an accumulation of experiences that amount to her personal history up to this moment in time. What the Sophia story should make clear is that while it may be tempting to ascribe her health issues to poor choices on her part, a more nuanced understanding of her personal history proves that any such interpretation is vastly simplistic and incomplete. History teaches us that many of the conditions that shape our health are outside our control. There is little Sophia could have done, for example, to avoid asthma with her home so close to dangerous pollutants. There is also little she could have done to educate herself about safe sex in the absence of any resources that would have helped her do so. And there is nothing she could have done to have been born into wealth and all the health advantages money can bring. Perhaps the most tragic aspect of Sophia's history is that it represents a cycle that her daughter is likely to repeat just as Sophia's story came to mirror that of her own mother. In the United States, we like to tell ourselves that anyone can transcend the circumstances of his or her birth through the application of hard work. The data tell a different story. More than 40% of Americans who grew up at the bottom of the economic ladder remain there as adults, with only 4% managing to rise to the top. Given this reality, Sophia's past will likely shape her daughter's future, just as her mother's past shaped hers. Our health is also intergenerational, influenced by our parents' health and their parents' health. This influence starts to mold our health before we are even born, starting with how our parents' health determines our own experiences in utero. Low birth weight, LBW, is an example of this. The term LBW is applied when a child is born weighing under 5 pounds 8 ounces. A baby's chances of being born with LBW are closely linked with her mother's experiences during pregnancy. Parental substance use can contribute to LBW risk. So can age. Giving birth under the age of 17 or above the age of 35 increases the likelihood of the child being born with LBW. LBW is linked to low income, lack of education, and unemployment. It is also tied to stress, including racialized stress. A 2017 study found that infants born to Latina mothers in Iowa after the major immigration raid in Postville had a 24% greater risk of LBW. The potential health effects of LBW are significant. The condition can lead to a number of problems for the child later on, including obesity, diabetes, and heart disease. The influence of our past may also run deeper than we suppose. Evidence suggests that even the conditions of parents' early lives may affect their children's health. Research has shown how, when children are exposed to difficult socioeconomic conditions, it increases the risk that their own children will develop asthma. Once we are born, the influence of our parents combines with our own early experiences to set the stage for health throughout our individual lives. Childhood trauma, for example, has been linked with significantly higher odds of later marijuana and cocaine use. Individuals who start drinking before the age of 14 are at greater lifetime risk for alcohol dependence. But it is education that has perhaps the greatest effect on our health trajectory through the years. In 2006, a 25-year-old man without a high school diploma could expect to live more than 9 years less than a 25-year-old man with a bachelor's degree or higher. This life expectancy gap was more than 8 years for women. The health risks of low education have even been compared, in terms of their mortality, to the dangers posed by smoking. This probably isn't news to anyone listening to this. In fact, much of what's contained in this book is, perhaps, science that is familiar to educated listeners. And yet, for all we know, we often cannot help but think that it is all inevitable, that it does not apply to us, or that with enough medicine we can buy our way out of our past and our circumstances and be as healthy as we want to be. But in fact, we have no choice but to think about the past when we consider health. When we ignore the past, we risk overlooking how the forces that shape our lives and our world also shape health across generations. It makes us less likely to address these conditions, feeding the sense, and the myth, that health is solely a product of our individual choices and the medicines we take. It has implications for where we invest and how we act. Consider the U.S. National Institutes of Health, NIH, the U.S. government's highly funded agency for medical research. The NIH is made up of 27 institutes and centers, each tasked with studying a particular disease or physiological system, funded according to the burden and urgency of the specific diseases they address. These organizations include a National Cancer Institute, a National Eye Institute, a National Institute of Mental Health, and a National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute. All do important work. However, their scope is limited to the present. There are no institutes devoted to studying the cumulative influence of the past on health. In other words, the NIH is interested in Sophia's diabetes, but it has yet to fully reckon with the history that produced it, nor with the socioeconomic conditions that characterized this history. This orientation is to be expected for the NIH. It is a reasonable reflection of how we view health in our society. Disease, in the popular conception, has an immediacy to it. It seems to strike suddenly, like a storm. But the reality, of course, is that storms develop slowly over time, relying on the right set of weather conditions to give them the force to make landfall. Disease, too, requires conditions plus time to produce its effects. More often than not, we devote our attention to addressing these effects at the expense of addressing the time and conditions that created them. This approach distorts our view of disease, even leading us to blame sick people for their own poor health. We look at someone like Sophia and judge her present health without taking into account her past. We see her obesity and assume that she eats too much because she is weak-willed. We see her wheeze and dismiss her as a smoker, too headstrong to care about the risks. We see her work a low-wage job and conclude that she is too unintelligent to do anything else. These judgments are manifestly cruel. They are also common. Common enough to serve as the basis for much of our public policy. They show why, if we do not think about the past when we think about health, it's not just Sophia's health that will not improve. It's our collective health. The United States has a system of 6 federal programs that are designed to promote health among individuals and families of lesser means. These programs provide nutrition assistance, insurance coverage, and income subsidies, and are often housed under the umbrella term welfare. In practice, the beneficiaries of welfare programs are doggedly antagonized and even penalized for their need, forced to repeatedly prove that their difficulties are not the products of their own low character. Our welfare policies are written and updated in ways that appear to assume laziness among those who would dare to use them. We implement Medicaid work requirements and drug tests and are skeptical of universal health care, with some decrying it as a socialist plot to make responsible, healthy people subsidize the dissolute sick. This all represents an ahistorical view of health. It ignores generations of history. Not just the history of individuals, but the history of a country where a deeply unequal past has given way to an only marginally less unequal present. Worse, these actions channel political will in the wrong direction, away from improving the conditions that truly shape health. When a politician criticizes someone like Sophia, he or she ignores the fact that the zoning policies of Sophia's city allowed a bus depot to be built next to her apartment building, causing her asthma. We don't ask critical questions, like why Sophia's mother could not elevate her family into the middle class, despite working so hard she barely had time to see her child. We aren't troubled by the thought that we may be collectively responsible for this history, and this is evident in our inaction around the conditions that make it repeat itself. And as a result, we are less likely to see how ignoring history is a global problem, predicting and perpetuating cycles of violence and poverty that undermine the health of millions. Failing to recognize the role of the past affects the health of all of us, even those fortunate enough to live unaffected by the factors that colored Sophia's life. Because if our federal funding focuses only on our medical needs today as if they are lightning strikes, then we'll never understand how the car accident we happened to be involved in when we were children can increase our risk of diabetes and depression in adulthood, and most important, how we can prevent these conditions after these experiences. And if we focus only on diet plans that aim to improve our weight today, we will not devote any attention to making sure we are not exposed to the calorie-dense, nutrient-poor foods as children that will saddle us with obesity throughout our life. To avoid this thinking, we must address the structures that surround us every day, the conditions that shape who we are and who we will become. A closer look at racism in America, for example, reminds us how history, in this case slavery, can become embedded in the systems that organize our society and in the very bodies of the people who live and work within these systems. It is a sad truth that Black Americans have long had poorer health than white Americans. They have a higher risk of many diseases, including heart disease, diabetes, and stroke. They also live consistently shorter lives than whites, though this gap has narrowed in recent years. These health gaps are neither random nor inevitable. They are a consequence of history. Centuries of slavery, socioeconomic and political exclusion, and the daily bigotries that emerge from a culture where discrimination remains endemic have all contributed to the poor health of Black Americans. These conditions are systemic, with roots in the earliest days of colonization on this continent. If the history of these conditions is the iceberg, then present-day Black mortality is its tip. When we understand how the past informs our present health, we also see how we might engage with historical forces to reverse what hurts us and to improve with what makes us well. This means taking an honest look at the systems that we have built over time, acknowledging their flaws, and working to correct them. Engaging with the past also means recognizing that health is not something that is fixed to a particular moment. It does not happen in an instant, and it is not a result of sudden disease or cure. Rather, it unfolds over time. Our early experiences influence our health throughout life, and our health, in turn, shapes the health of our children. This argues for improving the conditions that shape health at all stages of life, ensuring that our children inherit the healthiest possible history. 2. Money. In 1863, with the U.S. Civil War raging, Congress passed the Enrollment Act, the first federal military draft in American history. The act made every male citizen between the ages of 20 and 45 eligible for Union military service. Enforcement of the draft proved controversial, notably leading to the New York City draft riots, the most destructive civil disturbance in the city's history. Anger over the draft was centered on one of the legislation's caveats. The Enrollment Act allowed individuals to buy exemptions from military service for the cost of $300. This led to the perception that the Civil War was a rich man's war and a poor man's fight, and fueled the anger of the New York City rioters, many of whom were economically disadvantaged Irish immigrants with no money to purchase exemptions. Economic inequality also shaped the fighting force on the Confederate side. In the South, one exemption was granted to white men for every 20 slaves owned on a plantation. These are dramatic historical examples, but they're cited here to illustrate a point. Money buys health. More than 600,000 soldiers died in the Civil War, whether from combat, accident, starvation, or disease. The power of money and property to secure exemptions, which allowed the wealthy to sidestep the hazards of the war, shows how security and well-being tend to follow affluence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.